Have a good night. Or have a good weekend. Have a good week.
Have a good week. Good night and a good weekend. Hello everyone, and welcome back to The Uncaging with ya boys Satyam Khanal and David Toro.
How's everyone doing?
As y'all know by now, this podcast is dedicated to Nicolas Cage in all his glory, and we follow his movies in chronological order. Although, we also have some special episodes, like the ones we uploaded recently, that may not be on his movies. Go check them out if you haven't. In this particular episode, we look at the 1986 Canadian drama movie, The Boy in Blue, directed by Charles Jarrett, starring Nicolas Cage, Cynthia Dale, and Christopher Plummer, among others. The movie is loosely based on a true story of the Canadian sculling world champion, Edward Ned Hanlan, and it follows his early days into getting into the sport. And as usual, spoilers warning ahead. Please go and watch the movie before coming here and joining us. Although for this one, it was really hard to find the movie. So if you have trouble, email us at theuncaging@gmail.com or reach out to us in any of our channels, Instagram, that may be easiest. And we shall send you the link. David Beta, how are you?
Doing well. How has your week been?
It's been okay. Mostly working from home. I'm on the writing phase for my work. And as you know, it's been a crazy week, but let's not get into politics. We want to keep that for when we talk with Ali and the others, for a spicy discussion. And so it's been an interesting week. I think next week is going to be pretty interesting as well. Let's see how things turn out. But in other news, just surfed this morning. As you know, I've been playing a bunch of Stardew Valley and I'm loving it. I'm slowly building my repertoire as a great farmer in the game, and it's super nice and relaxing. So it's been good. How about you?
Good week. Like you said, very strange politically, but other than that, we just painted our bathroom, which was it was very rewarding. A lot of work, but it was very, very rewarding. And now we know how to paint a room, so we don't have to hire anyone to come paint for us.
That's so awesome, dude. What color was it?
So it was like, I don't know if you can see the walls here, but they're kind of like a light gray. And
it's not eggshell white like Michael.
It is not. Okay. It was a light gray, and we were just so bored of it. It was so dull. So we painted it a pretty light pinkish color, and it gives off like a light kind of atmosphere when there's not that much light at night and in the morning. So at night it just looked like a cave, because it was gray in essence. It was light gray, but yeah. And we've been playing Stardew Valley as well, like we just spoke about. It's just so much fun. For anyone who plays or has not played Stardew Valley, they just came out with an update in December that includes many other things. It's a pretty cheap game in Steam. I think it's if you take into account everything that it includes, I think it rivals games like Red Dead Redemption, Cyberpunk even, which I haven't played but I want to. But in terms of content and hours you can play, I definitely compare it to that, to those AAA games now, and get it if you can. It's super fun and rewarding as well.
Yeah, it's like your mobile farming game, but then it's way more expanded, way more intricate, and it has a lot of like Minecraft feel to it too, because you're building constantly, in different ways, you're fighting monsters, you know, all those things. So yeah, it's a super fun game.
Yeah, it is. All right, Shall we get into The Boy in Blue?
Yes, let's do.
All right, so The Boy in Blue, like you just spoke about, it's a biopic about Ned Hanlan, a Canadian sculler. Like we had said right before our Christmas episode, I had no idea what sculling was. I knew what it looked like, but I didn't know that it was called sculling, and I didn't know that there would be this Canadian world champion that would almost be like Hercules in a way. He seemed almost like a hero. And then we'll talk about his actual life versus the movie. I read a bit of his Wikipedia, which I think shows how much better he was than even portrayed in the movie. So Ned in the movie, he comes from a humble beginning, and he suddenly gets discovered by, another Canadian rival. He becomes his manager, and then they go off to the U.S. to compete in specific sculling competitions. He gets better and better throughout the movie, and of course there are obstacles, which we will talk about. And at one point he gets banned from competing in the U.S., and then they kind of, not necessarily a loophole, but they figure out that if they just go to England to take place in this championship, it's the world championship, I think, the one they do in England. He eventually wins it, so the ban in the U.S. is pretty much useless, because, like, what, you're going to ban a world champion? So more of the actual history of that to come. But yeah, and then at the end he marries his sweetheart, and he becomes the world champion for many years, and then the movie ends, and we get a little historical blurb about him there at the end. But overall, I just want to say that the movie itself was not my favorite that we've seen of him. I think it was probably one of the, what I'd say, maybe like in the 25% lower, like bottom fourth for sure. But he does a pretty good job. I think there are a few scenes in there that that he again shows his acting chops, and I think, and the physical preparation that I think that role required is great for him, because as we've seen, he's pretty ripped too, so I'm sure that helped. What were your thoughts on the movie?
So yeah, throughout the movie, let's just keep comparing the real Ned Hanlan versus the movie's version, because I think it's good to talk about both and kind of compare and contrast how the movie did things differently. So for me, I thought the actual Ned Hanlan was way more interesting than the movie's version of it. The movie definitely took his life and added some, in India and Nepal, we say masala. So the thing you add into like curry and stuff to make it taste better, you know, like spices. So it definitely felt like they added some masala into his life. Just so the movie would follow the stereotypical athlete's journey. You know, you have the beginning where they're a prodigy, but they need to be found out. Then they start winning. Then there's the trough where they get ahead of themselves somehow, or some obstacle happens, and then they lose everything they have. And then they have to kind of rise up and overcome that obstacle and become the hero again, right? So like a hero's journey. But honestly, I don't want to sound arrogant or anything. I'm not a movie maker, right? But honestly, if you had given me the reins to script this movie, I think I would have actually based it on his life, because his life was seriously very interesting. So I'm thankful to this movie to introduce me to the real Ned Hanlan. So let's go about breaking it down, like, as we talk. But right at the beginning, I thought it was super interesting how we start off seeing Ned as this, like amateur sculler, but also a person who, is like a bootlegger, and who ferries, moonshine that they're making in Canada. So I guess they live in somewhere near Toronto and kind of shipping it to the US. I guess it's around, it's during Prohibition, if I'm not mistaken.
The movie set. I don't know when Prohibition started, but the movie takes place in the 1870s, 1880s, 1890s. So, but I mean, there has to be some sort of prohibition there, because yeah, you're right. They were ferrying alcohol illegally to the U.S.
Right. And it's actually funny. So, I wanted to know more about Prohibition for the longest time, but I was not super motivated. I was like, oh, you know, like it, Prohibition. I knew kind of when it was and like I knew generally about it, but this movie kind of tipped me over to really looking it up and knowing about it. And there's I found this really cool channel on YouTube called Oversimplified, where the guy explains things in a very like easy to understand way. And Prohibition was one of, I think it was a two-parter. And there was so there were two videos on it, and I found it really fascinating. I would recommend it to you and all the listeners. So this definitely fell in the Prohibition period. And the guy in the video said that, yeah, the main source of alcohol for the U.S. was either through Canada illegally, or you have religious institutes that use alcohol for, you know, religious things like wine for Christianity, or you have doctors prescribing it for you know, pain medication or whatnot. So you had those kind of bartering, or like prescribing whiskey to or rum to whatever, you know.
That's so interesting.
And you had awesome, like pastors and stuff having the license to get it, and then they would just like illegally sell it. A lot of them got caught as well, but it was this problem that, so alcoholism was a problem they thought Prohibition would curb, but then it actually ended up getting worse because mobs got it. Because when a commodity becomes illegal, mobs definitely profit out of selling it in the black market or like what have you. So it was super interesting, but I found it interesting that the movie starts off that way. And if you compare it to the real life Ned, actually Ned was not bootlegging in real life. His family was Toronto residents, and he actually had to row every morning to go to school for like, I don't know how many kilometers. And so he was really good at that. And then his family was also like fishermen. So he had to sell the fish to the market like earlier than everyone else. So that process of like getting up early, rowing really hard to sell their fish in the first opportunity was what apparently got him into rowing and like being good at it. And then he slowly kind of climbed the ladder of the amateur scene first, and then like in the movie went to Philadelphia, and then slowly the world over kind of the world knew about him and all that. But I thought it was interesting how the way it started.
So I found it interesting how it started too, especially the context that the movie says that he grew up in humble beginnings. But then when you look at his actual biography, I don't think they were as poorly off as they portray in the movie. His father was an hotelier, whatever, however you pronounce it. So they managed a hotel that eventually, when Ned Hanlan retired from sculling, he inherited, and he went into the hotel business. So, yeah, like you said, that's one difference. And I find it very interesting what you just said about the religious institutions using alcohol, because if you remember, the priest at the very beginning is the guy who is persecuting Ned Hanlan for bringing the alcohol in. And he like wants to have the cops arrest Ned. So I thought that was interesting, and it's weird too that the priest never comes back. I thought that the priest had it out for him for something that he had done, but it just seems kind of an exposition of the whole prohibition thing and ferrying the alcohol. I guess it gives us a historical context into the era, not necessarily the character. but the movie is based on the character. So yeah, I think that was a strange scripting decision.
Yeah, and I guess it ties into the first trip to Philadelphia really well, that he was caught smuggling alcohol, and then the police figured out who he was. And it turns out, we later learned that it was Billy, the guy who's asking to manage him, that actually set the whole thing up, so that Ned would then had no other way than to join him to go to Philly to even escape the police. This is kind of foreshadowing on how Billy is as a person and what he'll do later on in the movie as well. But I guess the choice to have him, smuggle moonshine was to then set him up to be forced to go to Philly. So I guess in that sense, it makes sense. They could have just chosen the easy route of like, but maybe, I don't know. Like I said, like to add spice to the movie, I guess.
So one quick thing on that, and correct me if I read it wrong, but I thought that it was kind of fantastical the way that he goes back to Philly and then comes back to Toronto. But that did, in general terms, it did happen in his life, because he was being run out from Toronto and he came back to Toronto a few days after having won this championship there for the first time. And everyone kind of like welcomed him and pardoned him, which I thought was really interesting, because the movie, I feel like it's not that it glosses over because it's the intro, but I feel like they go through it pretty quickly. And it stood out to me because it's like, this doesn't make any sense. Like, if they're going after him before he wins the championship in Philly, they're not going to care, because maybe it's my assumption that I didn't know that so many people would be sculling fans back then. Maybe it was a much bigger, it's like maybe a Cristiano Ronaldo today, where people revere him and consider him as a god. That's kind of also exposition to us, because the fact that they're willing to pardon him just because he's become this champion and has so much potential.
Mm-hmm. Apparently once he became world champion, like all of that region of which predominantly still is French Canada, I think, like the English speaking people of that part of Canada, kind of that he was the kind of glue that kept them all kind of together, or like, you know, like supporting him was like the thing that all of everyone from like the top of the ladder to the bottom had in common. So yeah, I think that is pretty cool. And you're right, sculling may have been, and maybe still is, like pretty big there, you know.
Yeah, I have no idea anything about sculling. I do it in the gym. When we were in the office, we had a rower. I did that. That's all I know about sculling.
It's also a House of Cards, I think. Does rowing a lot, right? As exercise. Name?
Frank Underwood, his basement.
Yeah, that's what it reminded me of as well.
Yeah.
But something super interesting was the fact that his coach invented and later patented the seat that when you're rowing, it kind of slides back and forth. I thought that was super interesting, because Hanlan in real life, as well as in the movie, you see, was extremely gifted as a rower. So he already had that going for him. And then the sliding seat, it was like a double whammy, you know, like, so in real life too, he apparently lost only 6 of 300 games or sculling matches. And like, even those were like kind of exceptions where he was either very ill and hadn't recovered that well, or there was this one guy, an Australian blacksmith apparently, named Bill something, who was better than him, like legit better than him.
Something that I didn't like how they portrayed in the movie is his superiority to everyone else, because you read his brief bio and there are instances where he finishes the race, he goes back exactly to where the second place is going,
yeah,
and then beats him again.
Yeah, yeah.
So
yeah.
Like, I don't know why even in the race of the Thames or the Thames in the movie, they have him as the underdog, even when he's been so big. It's his first world title, but his aura like breaks, and the other guy is like, you know, he's having the time of his life. He's in front. It should be the opposite. But I guess if you make a movie where the hero is so superior, then what's the point, you know?
That's why I didn't really like the fact that they twisted it so much, when the original story would have been super fun as well. Like, can you imagine Nic Cage being super cocky? Like, apparently even that Australian guy that mocks him in and that gets him barred the first time. By the way, I don't even know if he really got barred. I think that might just been for the movie.
Yeah, that's another thing that I wanted to,
exactly,
talk about. Yeah.
So apparently he was the one that did the mocking to that guy, like zigzagging and like sleeping. Apparently he lay flat on his boat for like minutes until the guy closed in and then started rowing fast again and like blowing kisses to the crowd and stuff, you know? Like, can you imagine Nick doing that in the movie? That would have been amazing.
I think we should write a script. I think we should get Ned Hanlan's actual bio or autobiography, if you wrote one, and send him a script, a revised script to do The Boy in Blue 2.0. But yeah, the banning, for example, let's talk. Well, before we get onto the banning, so the way that I don't like how the movie progresses the story is how it causes things to just happen. So when they're in Philly for the first time, Ned needs a boat.
Also, they're in a weird circus. Did you notice that?
Yeah,
like,
yeah,
I don't know why they were in a weird circus. Like, is sculling like so weird that it's part of a circus? That was weird.
So it just happens. There just happens to be a little boy there that overhears them that they need a boat. And he's like, I'll give you a boat for $1. And then they go into this barn. And they find this guy with the invention of the century.
I know.
So you're telling me that telling me that if Ned Hanlan had not been there because he overslept, or they had been in another different part of the festival, that they would not have encountered that seat. I mean, maybe it did happen. I didn't read anything about that. It seems way too fantastical to me.
Yeah.
And way too just happened. Happenstance, or
it
just happens.
It just fell
because
in
it
his
needs
lap.
To happen.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
It needs to happen, so they just make it happen the cheapest way possible.
Yeah. I think that guy was just his coach, and I mean, of course, it's a huge coincidence that you have this fantastic athlete, exceptional athlete, and then his coach patents the. But it may have been in real life a process where they worked together and like over time, like. He figured out, or they together figured out, you know, like maybe you could make this kind of sliding seat to maximize his potential. And then he patented it, and now it's like so commonplace, or like, you know, so well established, you know.
Right. I think that, I mean, that's definitely how it went down. And hey, it could be by chance. Things happen by chance.
Right.
But yeah, it just seems way too far-fetched.
Yeah. Yeah. Another thing I found kind of funny was. I think this is like where they tried to have comedy. It was kind of comical, but the Philly, was it the Philly races where he was, they attempted to sabotage him like two or three times, but he managed to survive. Yeah, I thought that was kind of funny.
Yeah, they first try to poison him with a beer, and then that other guy drops dead, the reporter, who he is the guy who gives him the nickname the Boy in Blue because of the shirt that he wears in the first race. And then, yeah, because they're trying to fix the races for the next day. And I find it curious because it happens with horse racing. And we go back to the Cotton Club and the mobs with the horse racing. And then The Godfather, I think that was a nice kind of illusion.
Everything comes together, yeah.
Right, where the same kind of manipulation occurs just to, and we'll see that later with Knox. With his character. But okay, another, if we progress through the story, Ned wins Philly, he goes back to the US, and then he encounters Knox and
to Canada,
his niece.
You mean?
Sorry, yes, he
yeah,
goes
yeah.
back to Toronto. Yeah, yeah, from
yeah.
Philly to Toronto.
Yeah.
He encounters Knox and he's taken an interest in him and his niece as well. I think that the way that the way that Ned just dismisses his girlfriend is completely messed up. And just falls in love with the niece, and we never hear about the girlfriend again. I think
she marries Billy.
But it just felt like really, that's it?
Honestly, the whole romantic side of the movie was unnecessary. Like, that was just shoehorned into a hero's tale where he ends up winning the girl, you know? Like, why was that there? Like, it brought nothing to the plot. Absolutely nothing. He didn't grow because of it. She kind of gave him information that her uncle was planning something at the end. But, like, everyone knows his uncle is like a... Or her uncle is like a weird... The only good thing she did was tell him that the contracts shouldn't be 50-50.
Okay. I have a problem with that scene. Because you're telling me that happened that way as well? Well, first of all, I don't think that area happened, because it wasn't mentioned on the thing that I read. But how stupidly obvious is that? Like, okay, you're concerned for him because he needs to review the contract with a lawyer, but why is it written that obviously, where she's pouring the tea and she just says, "Hey, uncle, I think that Ned should review this with a solicitor." And then Ned is like, I think you're right.
Right, yeah.
I don't know. It's so ridiculous. It's way too obvious.
I was thinking he would bring back Billy as his lawyer, you know, at that point. It didn't happen, but
You would have written a better script.
I know, it was ridiculous. Yeah. But yeah, the whole uncle sponsoring him, I thought they tried to add kind of complexity and this complex of first of all class, which sets him up with the others, because a lot of the young guys we see in the movie are what I would call chads in modern terminology. So these guys are like Harvard graduates or like going to Harvard, and they have this opinion on Ned because he's, you know, like, I don't know, lowborn or coming from a poor background. So the fact that the girl's uncle was this manipulative guy who tried to take advantage of him, sure, okay, it makes sense. It's like early version of like a mob controlled asset or like what have you. But yeah, I agree with you. Like, some of the things that happened in that house were like so bizarre and out of place.
One other thing with Margaret, which is the woman that he ends up marrying, is how sudden the marriage is. They're fighting, one, and also that was a great scene, Nicolas Cage-wise, when he runs after the horse carriage.
Yeah.
Dude, the speed that he picks up is insane. He runs like an animal.
He's an athlete in this movie, like legit.
Yeah. Okay, the preparation that he must have done must have been crazy, because you can see the fibers of his muscles.
Yeah, yeah. He's rowing. Absolutely ripped. He's absolutely.
And
ripped.
when he's doing the gymnastics stuff with the gymnast rings, that stuff, I cannot imagine that's easy at all.
Yeah, yeah, for sure.
But how suddenly the marriage occurs. So there's that scene where he runs after the carriage, and then not 2 minutes later we see them just bells tolling and they come out of the church.
I mean, Margaret is just a flip-floppy character in general throughout the movie. I think she's like, she doesn't want to be with him because she's engaged. Then she takes pity on him. It's like, you know, it's like very, she's used for as a plot device to like kind of hinder him but help him. Like, you know, she's like fulfilling multiple roles.
I think the fact that the whole Knox thing doesn't seem to have happened in real life just introduces... Oh,
yeah. Yeah.
Imagine as a writer, I've never written a script, but imagine basing something on someone's life. You have the life of that person who is extremely successful and doesn't seem to have had any professional challenges becoming who he was. Making a movie out of him, it would be a pretty boring, very, very routinely made movie, I think. Not very exciting. So then introducing this whole chunk of plot that potentially just didn't happen, it introduces what you just said. It introduces challenges, because you're creating characters for the sake of a plot. And if that plot didn't happen, then as a writer, you have to come up with resolutions, why things happen, reasonings, motivations.
Yeah.
You just...
It's like when Game of Thrones went out of the rails completely after they ran out of source material. Like, from season 6, 7 onwards, the writers of the show started taking... I mean, they were kind of pushed into the corner because George R. R. Martin, the writer, just hasn't even finished it yet. But it's exactly this case where, like, once you are adding your own imagination onto something, like, unless it's polished really well, it's just going to come off as so desynchronized.
Yeah. Another thing, another maybe plot hole, just question that I have, and maybe it did happen, but he, in the Boston race, he crashes into the guy purposely, and they bar him for life. Did you also think that that was just a bit extreme to do a barring for life?
Yeah, I think so, for sure. Yeah, that was... I mean, I have no idea how sculling works. Maybe that was fair. But yeah, it's... And it's funny, because he's barred from the US, but then he can still row anywhere else. Like, it's like... I don't know, do I feel bad for him for being barred for life? But it's from the US, so do I not feel bad for him? You know? It's kind of awkward. But yeah.
I think that could also be writing, because, and I don't know how these sports work, they could be different, but like Formula One, if you get barred, it's an international sanctioning body. So sure, you can do regional races if you want that very few people watch, or you don't do Formula One. Yeah, similar to like FIFA. FIFA is international. If FIFA bans you, you cannot play with any sports team that is, I don't want to say sponsored by, but like sanctioned by FIFA. Any league that is sanctioned by FIFA, I guess, is the term. So, another thing that I found interesting is how few people are contesting in the championships.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Oh, when I think of sculling now in the U.S., or not in the U.S., sorry, in the Olympics, when you turn on the Olympics, there are tons of people and there are heats, just like in track and field, where you run like 4 quarterfinals and then 2 semifinals, and then the top of those 2 semifinals make it into the final. I'm sure that it's the same thing currently in the Olympics with sculling. It surprised me that in the world championship in London, there's only 2 people. And maybe it was done because it's either budgeting or maybe there were 2 people contesting the world champion. I don't know.
So I wonder if it's like you can challenge the champion for a 1v1, you know? And if you beat the champion,
that could also be true.
Like, we know he was Canadian champion. So maybe he could have, as the Canadian champion, he could have contested for the world championship. But let's kind of rein things back into this story. So you had the Philly race where he won and drew. He went back to Canada. He won a bunch of stuff again under the sponsorship of the uncle. I don't remember his name. Knox, was it?
Knox, yeah. Colonel Knox.
Exactly. And then he went to Boston, and there he faced the world champion, who was this Australian guy, who was really good, but he didn't play by the books, so he, which was not the case in real life, but he kind of teases and taunts him into committing a foul, wherein Hanlan gets banned from ever competing in the U.S. And then he gets dropped by Knox again. Or sorry, he gets dropped by Knox, who now picks up, was it like Traeger or something? The Australian, the world champion. And then Ned has to figure out. And I have actually a funny kind of what I think about that whole aspect as well, because I didn't like how that went too.
So that's the point when Ned goes back to his coach, not Bill.
Yeah.
Because, wait, has the falling out with Bill happened at that point or not?
It has. Because when the...
Okay.
So Bill was the one that tried to sabotage the Australian guy Traeger's boat. But then Ned wanted a fair fight. So he said, oh, check your boat, you know. So Bill and Knox are both mad at him for doing that because, you know, he ended up not winning. And then he had a fallout with both of them. And then he went back to the OG guy who made that the seat, the sliding seat in the first place. His name is like George
Warren.
George Warren, yeah. So he went back to the guy and said he wanted to wanted another chance. But since he was banned from the US, he said, well, let me compete in the world championship at Thames. I think did they just say the English Channel or the Thames in particular? I don't remember.
They did it in the Thames in London.
Okay. Now the thing I found kind of unconvincing or kind of funny was the thing that makes protagonists kind of hero's journey special is that training phase where they go through this intense training to overcome this extremely high barrier, and then when they achieve it, it's like this this big accomplishment, right? But the funny thing here is even in real life, like, Ned is way too OP from the very beginning, so I don't think he needed that at all. But even in the movie, like, I don't know about you, but I felt like he was already super good. And the only reason he lost was because he had the whole mental barrier thing, where he had a falling out with his old coach, old manager, Billy, and the whole thing with the girl of his, you know, his sweetheart getting engaged and whatnot, and then being taunted by Traeger. So in a fair fight, I think he would have won anyways. So the whole montage of him training, I thought was just like kind of pointless because he's already very good. Like, he's ripped from the very start of the movie. Like,
so I completely agree. It's as if they made the training scene with Rocky.
Yeah, that's instead
of
how
doing
I felt.
That at the beginning of the movie, they do it at the
end. Yeah, exactly. It was like Rocky, but like not with the same impact, you know?
Right. Yeah. And I think it goes back to the writing again. They need this obstacle to be just much bigger than any other potential obstacle from before. So one thing about the coach. So he wagers his $50,000 patent for the sliding seat against Ned winning. So if Ned loses, Knox gets the patent and he can get rich that way. So my issue is that the old man says that they offered him $50,000 for it. But in the final race, you see that the Australian guy also has a sliding seat. So what makes his design $50,000 if they're already making?
Did they though?
You know what I mean? Yeah.
Oh yeah. You checked?
So I actually checked. Oh. I rewinded and I did that the same with the first races, and you can tell because the camera actually focuses on the legs to really show the viewer what we're supposed to be looking at. But in the last race, I looked because part of the thing is
that,
like,
is definitely a plot hole. That's ridiculous.
Go back and watch it. This sliding seat is supposed to give them the advantage.
Right.
It's like, it's like Superman
real.
With laser,
like, that's
eyes.
He was the OG user, and then it took years for people to get to that level.
Go back and watch the final race because they both have the sliding seat.
Mm.
So I think either it's a script mistake or the old man is crazy to think that his patent is worth $50,000 at that point.
Wow, that's insane.
I thought he was just sliding on the boat.
Like, wow.
I really wanted it not for him to be sliding, but he's sliding.
Dude, why? Like. Yeah. That's terrible.
Yeah, I know. It's like they had two
oversight.
Backups of the boat.
Yeah.
Huh?
That's a huge oversight.
Complete oversight.
Damn.
Yeah. One very cool thing that I did learn is that the position that Ned Hanlan uses and the technique of his rowing is what is taught and used today.
Yeah.
Which I thought was incredible how something done by this guy 140 years ago is still the gold standard. Like, that's how good he was.
He absolutely revolutionized the seat and him, his the way he, apparently the way he used his whole body, like even his legs. Apparently before this, everyone just used their upper body strength and just like, you know, your arms go out straight and then you row. And apparently this guy was ridiculous, even though he was like only like 5'8 and 150 pounds. He could stretch out his arms and go beyond the perpendicular. So he could like somehow manage to really like bend his arm. And then he would then propel himself with his whole body. So that gave him incredible like momentum, you know. It was like a whole body exercise. I mean, even in surfing, we notice how good surfers differentiate themselves from like beginners, intermediates, by really like using their entire body to propel themselves. And yeah, that's what Ned did for sculling as well.
Yeah, it was a good look into a world that I wouldn't really even care to look at, to be honest with you. I've never been interested in rowing to any competitive level. I'm glad that I watched the movie, and I'm glad that I know this guy's name, because I feel like if I ever speak to any serious sculler or rower, there's a high chance that they will know who Ned Hanlan is if they have either gone to classes. It's like playing tennis and knowing who Nadal, Federer, you know, these massive names are.
Right.
So
Pele for football, what have you.
Yeah. Exactly. Just the gold standard. And I find it very interesting that the gold standard for that was in 1880.
I know. You know, that's, if you look at soccer, insane. Yeah.
We revere some soccer players, but the ones that we revere, old ones, are not necessarily the best. Now we see like Messi's and Cristiano Ronaldo's, who could potentially rival Pele's and Maradona's from the past. So yeah, any other thoughts from the movie before we get into Nicolas Cage?
No, not really. I mean, I'm ready to like rate it when we get to that stage. I mean, honestly, if I hadn't, or if this wasn't based on a real guy, and if his story was not interesting, I wouldn't know how much we would have been able to talk about it, because it was just so like run of the mill. Like athlete, like gained success in, you know, like it was a very stock and standard story.
I think it just followed the typical template for a sports movie, and like you had said before, I think it would have been great to see his actual life put into screen, because this guy, even though he was the best, I'm sure that he had a fascinating life and upbringing to make him the best. I mean, you can't be the best at anything and not have that special thing in you as your, in your character or your determination and motivation too. It's all self-driven. When you're at that stage, it's you. That's it. Especially in an individual sport like sculling. So yeah, not the best movie. I thought Nicolas Cage did a great job, like we've been discussing throughout. His acting is really good. I think it's probably one of his better roles up to now. I ranked him 8 out of 10 in this one. Did you give him a ranking?
Yeah, honestly, like, he was the saving grace for me for the movie. What I noticed sometimes was his smile was so genuine. Like, did you notice that? Like, he broke into totally. The smile, and it was so genuine. It's like, I don't know if that was him just happy to have this lead role again, like him giving 100%, like him just enjoying acting with those particular actors or what, but I so bought into his character. I enjoyed his more Rage Cage moments as well, like the time he pulled Margaret inside the house. That was ridiculous. Like, dude, she's not even your girlfriend. What are you doing?
Right, like,
you
know? Take it easy.
I know. And this is in like olden times, you know, where like it was this proper society. Kind of gave me the vibes of Valley Girl, where he's the like the straight talking dude, and then the girl is from like a more like higher social tier. But I agree with you. I think his commitment to the role, like physically as well as, you know, acting wise, I thought was fantastic. And I think, yeah, or like 7.5 or 8 is very apt for his role. Yeah, his early movies, I really like him for his earnest effort overall.
And I like the, I know that we just crapped completely over the training scenes, but like those close-up shots in the race and stuff, it like shows that he's actually rowing. And prior to filming that scene, knowing what he did with the prior movies physically, like in Birdie, the mouth thing and
he lost like 20 pounds for that role.
Yeah. So I wouldn't be surprised if he followed a usual training schedule to do this role, right. Which would be really interesting to find out if he did.
Yeah. Right. Exactly. We trashed the training sequence because in this context of the movie, it didn't make sense, but for him, it was fantastic, you know?
Yeah. I gave the movie a 3 out of 10, which I think is the lowest one, in the Uncaging.
Damn.
I'm getting more. See, this is what happens. The first thing you watch is going to be number one, you know? So as we grow our list, this is number 8 now. I would definitely put this one either at the bottom or second to last one. And it's primarily the story. It has nothing to do with Nic Cage. It's just the quality of the movie itself. And it's very sad to say because Christopher Plummer is in the movie too. And he's a great actor. He was in Sound of Music. What other movie was he in that I saw? He's been in a bunch. He's really famous and Canadian. So gives me an idea. Obviously, this is probably a Canadian production because it's a Canadian guy. So yeah, what did you rate the movie?
So for me to rate a movie below 5, it has to be unbearable. Like it has to be something that I just can't sit through, you know? This movie, just because of Nick's charisma and like I love seeing him on stage, I didn't feel that way. Like I was able to sit down and watch the movie, you know? So I think for me it was like a 5.5. Definitely probably at the bottom of the list of what we've seen so far. I think as a movie, Nic Cage's acting was definitely not at the bottom, you know? Like we've seen him in Fast Times that he was there? Yeah, he was there for like three.
Yeah, Fast Times, so he was there in for like a second, yeah.
So if it was a combo of those two things, oh my goodness, that would have been terrible.
So I'm particularly harsh when the writing is atrocious. When even I can list all the plot holes that don't have answers. So like I was telling you before, I wrote a list as of questions as I had as the plot kept going. And the more things that weren't crossed out by the end, I can't do it.
Did we address all of them? Lazy. We can talk
about that. Yeah, okay. It's pretty much all of them, yeah.
Okay.
So yeah, it's just lazy writing and I cannot stand it. It's like if I've read 45% or 50% of a book and it's just not good, I'll put it down. I'm not going to feel guilt because it's a waste of time, to be honest, you know? And you're doing it for entertainment. It's not like this isn't torture. It's just entertainment. So why would you suffer through entertainment?
Yeah, I agree with you. I mean, apparently even the Canadians were not happy with the movie. They would have rather seen a Canadian actor instead of Nick. I agree with them when they say he didn't really try to be Canadian in any sense. He was earnest about the role itself, like physically and acting wise, but it makes sense. And so far, he has not proved to be good adapting into like accents or mannerisms, like in the Cotton Club where he had to be from Harlem, and that was terrible. Like, dude, don't even try. Like,
yeah,
you cannot pass off as a person from Harlem. And it was the same case here, but other than that, I did enjoy his role. So yeah, the movie itself was pretty lame, I would say. Thank you.
Thanks for joining us on our 8th episode of The Uncaging. We just discussed The Boy in Blue, a biopic of Ned Hanlan, a champion Canadian sculler. Since starting the new year, we have started an Instagram and a YouTube page. Follow us for regular episodes and some more Nic Cage content. As usual, you can send us voice notes via our Anchor page, which will get featured on our next episode, and you can always send us an email to theuncaging@gmail.com. We're looking forward to watching and reviewing Peggy Sue Got Married, next week's movie. This is a rom-com starring Nicolas Cage and Kathleen Turner. Join us next week, and thank you for listening.
And keep your eyes and ears open for our next mini episode, which will drop sometime this week. As you know, we've been doing mini episodes on the Netflix docuseries History of Swear Words, and the next episode is on the word shit. So, right? I think so.
Yep, I think so.
Yeah, so we're enjoying watching.
Looking forward to that one.
Right. We're enjoying watching them and talking about them as well. So definitely be on the lookout for that. And shout out to, of course, the fans, whoever enjoys our content, but also to the innumerable Nicolas Cage followers and accounts and fans and, you know, content creators that we've connected to through Instagram. Shout out to all you guys. You guys are doing great. We are now a brotherhood of Nicolas Cage fans and lovers, you know. It's been really nice to, and literally every day there's someone new that you can follow that has some affiliation with Nicolas Cage, which is incredible, I think.
It's overwhelming how many Instagram pages there are with Nicolas Cage stuff. But yeah. Yeah, happy to be with them on Instagram and continue to,
exactly,
to be good disciples of Nicolas Cage.
Exactly. Hopefully one day we'll collaborate with someone there, you know. If they are looking forward to doing that, we're happy to do that. So
yeah, of course. And also look into our next episodes. We hope to have some guests, either for the mini episode or for a movie. And hopefully we can at some point reach out to someone on Instagram and have a quick interview with them.
Right, yeah. All right, that wraps up the episode. Peace out. Bye.